118. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgive the iniquity of my sins.
O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I am a poor sinner, and confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temple and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death, of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being.
Upon this short confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God to all of you. And in this head, by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We chant the new book together with Christians.
Thank you.
God, you make this most holy night to shine with the brightness of the true light. Grant that, that we have known the mysteries of that light on earth, and may also come to the fullness of his joy from heaven. To the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
For the nativity of our Lord is from Isaiah chapter 9. People who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shined. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy of the harvest, as they are glad when they will divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle torn, and every garment rolled in blood, will be burned as fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice, with righteousness, from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Chant the graduates get their printed. God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among among those with whom he is pleased. This is the gospel, this is the word of the Lord. We confess our faith together with the words of the Apostles' Creed as printed on page 192.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
May be seated with him today. Among those with whom he is pleased. For those of you that haven't been here for the Wednesday evenings, during the Wednesday evenings of Advent, we've been talking about the Advent wreath. Those of you that are here on Sunday mornings, I have the children, we talk about the different candles of the Advent wreath, beginning with the prophecy candle, the first candle, the Bethlehem candle, the second candle, the rose candle, the shepherd's candle, and this evening we're going to be talking about the fourth candle, the angel's candle. But actually, we've lit all of our candles on the Advent wreath. But again, we need to discuss the angel's candle, and then tomorrow morning we will discuss the center candle, the Christ candle. But of the circle, those candles in the circle, the fourth and final candle is indeed this angel's candle. This evening, we want to talk about the birth of the one promised as we talk about the work of the angel. God created angels to be his messengers. God created angels for the work of proclaiming his message to those to whom he would send, as well as their work is to watch over the people of God. Personally, I believe that each one of us has at least one angel, if not two or more angels, watching over us. And I'm sure that oftentimes children can actually see the angels. During the time of the preparation of the birth of the one promised back in the Garden of Eden, the birth of Jesus, Savior of the world, the angels did a lot of work. One of the first works of the angels was to deliver the message to Zechariah, the priest in the temple, that his wife of old age would give birth to the one who would be the forerunner, who would announce and prepare the way for Jesus, that is, John the Baptist. John was said to come in the spirit of Elijah. This proclamation was maybe about 6 months before the next angel's work, and that was the work to bring the message to Mary. The angel who brought the message to Mary actually has a name. We're not given many of the angels' names, but we are told that the angel Gabriel appeared to Mary to deliver the message to Mary that she was favored by God. And the angel says, the one favored by God. She was chosen by God to be the one who would be the earthly mother of the one promised. Because of her youth, because she was not married, because she understood the biology of the way children are born, the angel went on to explain to Mary how this immaculate conception would take place. That is, that she would become pregnant by the power of the Holy Spirit, so that the child to which she would give birth would indeed be truly God in human flesh. And as we know, Mary consented to be the mother of Jesus. The next work, the next angel's work we have is that appearing to Joseph. But we make note that this angel did not appear in person to Joseph. Rather, the angel appeared in a vision to Joseph in a dream. This angel explains Mary, or to Joseph, that Mary is pregnant, even though they are betrothed and not yet married. Explains that Mary has not committed adultery, nor has she been unfaithful, but that she is pregnant by the power of the Holy Spirit. And here again, we know also that Joseph agreed to be the adopted father of Jesus. Finally, we have the work of the angels that we hear about in our text for tonight. That of announcing the birth of Jesus to the shepherds. Last week, we heard a little bit about these lowly, humble shepherds who were the first to hear of the birth of Jesus and also the first to bear witness of the birth of Jesus. It was the angels who declared this wonderful news to the shepherds. But why are all these shepherds here? Are all these angels here? What are all these angels doing here at the birth of Jesus? Remember, the angels were created to be messengers of God, to do his bidding, but also to be protectors and defenders. Thus, we might rightly understand the angels, this host, notice a host of angels, host intimating that this was an army of angels, were here at Jesus' birth to work as defenders for the helpless Christ's child. The angels were there to protect this vulnerable child, perhaps especially from Herod's execution of the children born in Bethlehem. The angels appeared to Joseph just in time for him to escape from Bethlehem to go down to Egypt to save the baby Jesus. The angels were there to protect the baby from any attacks of the devil. Also, the angels were there to protect the child and his parents while going to and coming back from Egypt, and while they were there in Egypt. Although the children of Israel had spent many years in slavery in Egypt, Mary and Joseph were now foreigners in Egypt, thus they needed the protection of God's angels. The angel's candle also reminds us that angels are real and they are messengers from God. God created angels. And although Satan, whose name is Lucifer, meaning light bearer, was once one of God's good angels, we know that he rebelled, perhaps thinking himself to be God as well. Thus, God created hell for those evil angels. God separated the evil angels from the good angels, and although the devil, the evil foe, roams around like a roaring lion, even today, seeking someone to devour, the Lord has his pure, good, and perfect angels always guarding and protecting us. And they deliver to us the good news that God would have them deliver. The angel's candle reminds us that angels do God's bidding, as has been the case in many times in the Old Testament and the New Testament. To see God's angels is a remarkable experience, and as described in our text, when we are told that the multitude of heavenly hosts were seen there praising God, quite a spectacular event. The angel's candle reminds us that angels protect God's children. Again, I believe that children and babies can actually see their angels at times. Little children have not been tainted by the skepticism we adults are tainted with, and so they have no problem seeing these supernatural beings. The angel's candle reminds us that angels rejoice in God's goodness. Some of you have heard me say it before, but when we come to the Lord's table, when we come to divine service and sing praises, indeed, we are not alone. Would that God would open our eyes to see the multitude of heavenly hosts that is here with us, giving praise and glory to his holy name in the divine service. So this evening, we say, let the celebration begin. We have been preparing for just this moment for this evening. We have been preparing for this moment for our celebration of the birth of Jesus, which and who is the reason for the season. The Advent wreath that we've been talking about has been helping us to count down to this day. The Advent wreath has reminded us it was the angels who announced to the shepherds that in Bethlehem, the living God fulfilled his promise, the prophecy to send the Savior, Christ the Lord. We are ready to celebrate, and we remember, we celebrate for 12 days. Don't listen to the radio advertisements. The 12 days doesn't happen before Christmas. And we don't simply celebrate tonight and tomorrow, we continue to celebrate. We celebrate for all 12 days of Christmas. The 12 days of Christmas will last from Christmas Day until Epiphany. We call Epiphany is the day we celebrate the visit of the Magi, the wise men, the first non-Jewish people to come and see the baby Jesus. You know, there are actually families who, during the 12 days of Christmas, open a present each day as a way to continue to remember to celebrate the 12 days of Christmas. In our family tradition, we actually leave our lights up for the 12 days of Christmas. We celebrate and rejoice in God fulfilling his promise to send a Savior. God loves us so much. We see his great love in the fact that he knew all that was going to happen even before he began creating the world. That is, he knew Adam and Eve would sin. He knew he would have to be born in human flesh to be our substitute. He knew he would have to live perfectly for us, that he would have to take our sins and pay the price for our sins. He knew he would have to suffer. And yet, even knowing all of that, because of his great love for us, created us anyway, so we rejoice. We rejoice in Jesus, our substitute, and his gifts of faith, forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation. Thanks be to God that Jesus is our substitute. What we could not do, that perfectly did for us in our place. How can we not rejoice and celebrate? Jesus was born for a purpose, to live perfectly, to take our sins, to suffer and die. Indeed, we do celebrate, but we always celebrate in the shadow of the cross. For some, the Christmas tree, after it has died and lost all of its branches, some take that tree and form it into the shape of a cross in order to be reminded that the baby was born. May not be the most happy thought or a thought we like to make or want to celebrate, except that this baby is indeed God in human flesh. This baby is the one who loves us so much that he was willing to do anything and everything that needed to be done in order to save us. How could we not celebrate such great love for us as children? So we celebrate the birth of our Savior, Christ the Lord. We celebrate that he has fulfilled all of his prophecies, all of his promises, again with the angels announcing to the shepherds that in Bethlehem, the one who lives for us, takes our sins, suffers and dies for us, rose again from the dead, and gives us forgiveness, life, and salvation, and he stirs in us to rejoice and say, to God be the glory, for Jesus' sake. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds for faith in Christ Jesus for life everlasting. Amen. We continue with the offertory on page 192. Please rise. pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Amen. Mighty God, by the incarnation of your eternal Son, reveal that you are love. Give us true faith in Christ and his promise that by his conception, virgin birth, holy life, sacrificial death, and victorious resurrection, our sins are forgiven and we are yours. Increase our love for one another, for as you abide in us, we abide in you, and your love is perfected in us. Fill us with joy and lead us to proclaim your glad tidings to all people. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, by his birth in human flesh, your son took his place in the family of Mary and Joseph. Bless the families of our church and our country, that men and women would live faithfully as husbands and wives, loving and caring for their children and nurturing them through the grace of baptism and all the truth of your word. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, by your gracious provision, you granted to your church to be your family, where, nurtured by your word and sacraments, all of us may find a home filled with sisters and brothers to care for us, love us, and increase our joy. Make of us a refuge for the weary, a family for the lonely, a safe place for those who are afraid, and a help to one another in all our burdens. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, guide and defend the President, Congress, and all who administer and judge our laws. Change the hearts of those who lead us away from your justice and truth. Preserve in this land the freedom to serve you and to lead us to be faithful citizens. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father, in love, you declare us to be yours and promise to hear our prayers. Protect the police, fire personnel, and other emergency workers whose duty and service to us have called them away from their loved ones this night. Keep safe all who are traveling during this holiday season. Relieve the sufferings of your people and heal their diseases according to your mercy. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, our Savior, brother, you feed us in body and soul. Give true faith in your word and promises to all who receive your body for this time. Sustain your people in humble repentance and godly living. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In your hands, O Lord, we commit ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We continue with the service of the sacrament on page 194. The Lord be with you.
Thank you.
And when you give thanks, you gave it to the disciples, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Favor
and give you peace.
night of the first singing of this song, Silent Night, Holy Night. It was sang in St. Nicholas Parish Church in Oberndorf, a village in Austrian Empire. It was written, let me see if I get this right, by Franz Xaver Gruber, the schoolmaster and organist. What had happened was a flood had flooded the church. Their organ wasn't working, and so he needed something that could be played on a guitar. It was the guitar composer, and you can find this on Wikipedia, sorry, that's the best I can do. And I did look at this. There wasn't a different person that composed it, but then it was translated into English in 1859, and that's when it began to be sung in churches in English in America and so forth. So it is a beloved hymn. What I'd like to do, and I didn't tell Michael beforehand, so I'm going to tell him now so he can pay attention. If you look on page, on the opposite page, you've got Silent Night on 363. At the very bottom of the next page, 364, Matthew, is the text known to some Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. And that's the one that I remember growing up with. So what I'd like to do is sing the bottom of that page in German first, and then sing 1 through 3 on 363. And in honor of Pastor Mendez, maybe next year we'll sing a verse in Spanish too. So I think it will work out really well as well. But he's going to play a little bit. We'll light the candles. I will light the candle, off the Christ candle, have the elders come up. They will light your candle off the lit candle. Don't have them stick yours in. This is the lit candle. You'll light it off of that candle. And once we get the candles lit, I will turn off the lights. We'll sing the first verse there on the second page in German, Stille Nacht, Heilige Nacht, and then we'll sing the three on 363. Everybody got those?